Good morning. Welcome to the Duke Law Journal's 40th Annual Administrative Law Symposium. My name is Natalie Bedoya, and I'm the editor-in-chief of Volume 59 of the Duke Law Journal. Today is truly a dream come true for me. It was exactly 1 year ago that I began speaking to all of the authors here today, who each helped me brainstorm and develop the topic of today's symposium. It is so wonderful to have you all here, making our joint vision a reality. The papers you will see presented today all focus on critical aspects of immigration law and adjudication. The questions we will explore today include, how are the rights of unauthorized migrants enforced in the United States? How have immigration courts been affected by the increased involvement of local and state authorities in enforcing immigration law? Which branch of the federal government should make core immigration determinations? What are the effects of specialization in the adjudication of immigration cases? And finally, how can the immigration adjudication system be reformed to solve its current problems? These questions will all make for an engaging and stimulating conversation. I would also like to take this opportunity to thank several people who have worked especially hard to make today's symposium possible. A special thank you to Catherine Record, Patricia Richman, David Riesenberg, Corinne Oshima, and Nick Simon. Before we begin, I want to run through how each of today's three panels will work. Basically, we'll have the presenters of the paper and the commentators come up together to the front. We'll then have the first author present his or her paper for roughly 15 minutes. The commentator will then comment for roughly 10 minutes, and then we'll open it up for general questions and general discussion. I would like now to introduce Professor Hans Linnartz, who teaches immigration law here at Duke Law School. Professor Linnartz was an integral part of helping me shape today's symposium, and I'd like to thank him for helping me make today possible. Thank you to all of you, and I hope you enjoy today's discussion. Thank you.
It's been an interesting week in the news. On Monday, the American Bar Association's House of Delegates approved a resolution calling for the abolition of the Executive Office for Immigration Review in the Justice Department and its replacement by an Article I independent executive agency that would do both trial and appellate adjudications of immigration cases. That was just Monday. Tuesday, the Department of Homeland Security released a new estimate of the unauthorized migrant population in the United States, saying there are about 10.8 million unauthorized migrants in the United States, all of whom, since they're unauthorized to be here, are potentially subject to deportation through process in the immigration courts. Wednesday, Arizona Sheriff Joe Arpaio raised his head and announced that he would train all 881 of his deputies in Maricopa County to enforce the immigration laws and send them out on the streets to do so, notwithstanding the fact that the federal government has withdrawn its memorandum of agreement with Maricopa County under Section 287G. Sheriff Arpaio says, I've got the authority all on my own. We're going to keep doing this. Finally, yesterday, in San Francisco, an immigration judge granted asylum to an 11-year-old girl who was fleeing Honduras because of fear of gang violence. This decision in San Francisco is in significant contrast to a number of other decisions by immigration judges and by the Board of Immigration Appeals, which have frequently denied asylum claims based upon fears of gang violence. There's a lot of ferment going on. Now, that's just the first 4 days of this week. All this news has broken. With all this happening, the Duke Law Journal's decision more than a year ago to dedicate today's symposium to immigration adjudications, wow, is that prescient or what? If you guys have any Powerball numbers you want to share with me, I'll take them after the break. So my hat's off to them. This symposium is addressing a major subject of national discussion, something that has received, up to now, fairly light attention, especially in the academic community, yet something that could affect the lives of at least that 10.8 million unauthorized migrants, to say nothing about others who are, although not unauthorized at the moment, may face deportation proceedings because of things that happen inside this country. And it affects more than those numbers, too. It affects their families. It affects their employers. It affects all of us whose lives are touched by those whom we fondly call aliens. By way of announcement, please silence all cell phones, iPods, iPads, Blackberries, and other electronic devices. Those who fail to comply are subject to deportation. I am wearing an Immigration and Customs Enforcement badge. I am equipped, or I have authority to deport you, and I am equipped for the job. With that, I'll turn it back over to DLJ.
My name's Reed Enyon. I'm an articles editor for volume 59 of DLJ. Our first panel today features papers presented by Professor Hiroshi Motomura, Professor Jennifer Chacon, and comments by Professor Hans Linnartz. Professor Motomura received his Bachelor's of Arts from Yale College and his JD from UC Berkeley. He is currently the Susan Westerberg Prager Professor of Law at UCLA Law School, where he teaches civil procedure and immigration law. The co-author of two immigration-related casebooks, Professor Motomura is an influential scholar of immigration and citizenship law. His casebooks have won the Professional and Scholarly Publishing Award from the Association of American Publishers as the year's best books in law and legal studies, and have also been chosen by the U.S. Department of State as part of its suggested reading list for Foreign Service officers. Professor Motomura has served as co-counsel or as a consultant in several cases argued before the U.S. Supreme Court and the Federal Courts of Appeals. He has also testified before Congress as an immigration expert, and in the fall of 2008, he served as an advisor to the Obama-Biden transition team's working group on immigration policy. Today, Professor Motomura will be presenting his paper, The Rights of Others. Professor Jennifer Chacon received her Bachelor's of Arts from Stanford University and her JD from Yale Law School. She currently teaches statutory analysis at UC Irvine School of Law, and her areas of expertise are immigration law, criminal procedure, and criminal law. From 2005 to 2007, Professor Chacon served as an editor of Immigration Prof Blog, which is one of the most important online sources of news and commentary on immigration and the law. Professor Chacon also served as an outside advisor for President Obama's immigration transition team and as the convener of the Immigration Policy Advisory Committee for President Obama's presidential campaign. Professor Chacon's research interests center on the nexus of immigration law and criminal law. And I had the privilege of working with Professor Chacon with the paper that she's presenting here today as it works its way through the law journal editing process. Today, Professor Chacon will be presenting her paper, A Diversion of Attention, Immigration Courts and the Adjudication of Rights. And finally, Professor Hans Linnartz received his Bachelor of Arts from the University of Virginia and his JD from Duke Law School, where he currently teaches immigration law, as well as legal analysis, research, and writing. Professor Linnartz also directs the Summer Institute on Law, Language, and Culture. He is a certified specialist in immigration law, practicing as a consultant with the emphasis on the immigration consequences of criminal cases. And I will now turn it over to Professor Motomura.
Good morning. Actually, in California, I think it's 6:45 or something, but that's fine. I want to first start by thanking Natalie and Catherine and Patricia and everyone else on the Law Journal staff for pulling this together. This really has been a project that it takes a year to pull together, and having been involved in organizing symposia like this, I know how much work it is, so I really appreciate it, and I know everyone else here does as well. So what I thought I would do is to try to more describe my paper than to actually go through every point in it. If I were to go through every point in it, I have to speak very quickly, and it would really be like trying to drink out of a fire hydrant or something like that. But what I want to do is to just describe what the project is. As Professor Linnartz was saying, we have, as everyone knows, a very large undocumented or illegal or unauthorized, whatever term you want to use, population in this country. And one of my current projects is to write a book about this. And so what I'm going to share with you today is a chapter, maybe more than a chapter, out of this book. And it deals with this question of how we think about the rights of people who are here without legal authority. Do they have rights at all? And if we do have rights, I mean, that suggests that there's a certain degree of integration that they have in the legal system of the United States. And so that explains the title, The Rights of Others. And the paper, I have to admit, is constructed in perhaps an odd way. I look at four topics. The four topics are state and local laws. That would be an example of Joe Arpaio, I think, would be one of an embodiment, I suppose, of local law enforcement regarding immigration. The second topic is workplace rights. In other words, if you're working here in this country and you're not supposed to be here, can you file a claim for lost wages if you're hurt on the job? Can you file a claim for being underpaid if you're not paid the wages that you're entitled to? Can you organize? Things of that nature. The third topic is search and seizure law. In other words, to what extent does the Fourth Amendment apply to immigration enforcement? And the fourth question is the right to effective counsel in immigration court. In other words, if you're in immigration court where there happens to be no right to appointed counsel in the way that you'd have in criminal proceedings, what, however, might be your rights to effective counsel if you're represented on someone who then screws up? And the basic idea of the project is to look at these four areas and identify patterns where people who are not supposed to be in this country as a matter of law, and yet in many respects are tolerated, can nonetheless, in spite of their unlawful presence in this country, assert rights in some sense. And so the project is about trying to identify how that happens across these areas. And it's the four patterns that I identify, I'll describe, I'll label them now, but the labels will be probably completely incomprehensible until I explain them in detail. But just so that you have a sense of where I'm going with this, one type of argument is that the wrong person made the decision that adversely affects you. It's an institutional competence argument. The second type of argument I call comparative culpability, which is that you may have done something bad by being in the country illegally, but someone else that you're complaining against did something worse. The third is something I call citizen proxies, which is that regardless of the fact that you are asserting rights as someone who's not supposed to be in this country as a matter of law, you're really acting de facto on behalf of some other person's interest who is a citizen of the United States. The fourth is something I call a procedural surrogate, which is that there's a rule of procedure that protects you. And the fifth is something that I call phantom norms, which is the idea that that even though it looks like you're not supposed to have a certain right, courts and judges will interpret ambiguous statutes or regulations in a way that does grant that right anyway, a little bit at odds with what the letter of the law might seem. So let me walk through these. I'm just going to try to give you some examples of this because I think there are quite a few and probably too many to get into. So I'm one of these people. I'm not actually a big PowerPoint user, this is almost my first PowerPoint presentation, so wish me luck here. But I do have one rule, and when I do use PowerPoint, and that is have only one slide. Okay. So part of what I'm trying to set up here is that I'm setting up a spectrum, which is that if you're a U.S. citizen, you have what I'm sort of idealizing as a full version of a right. I'll explain more what I mean in a minute, but the whole point of the paper is to say that even if you don't have the full version of the right, in practice, you may be able to assert some oblique version of it. In other words, something that's a kind of a shadow, perhaps, maybe a pale shadow, maybe it's more robust. But the idea is that you may not, it may not seem like you're supposed to be able to do something under law, but it turns out you can. And so the first example I'll give you is state and local laws. You can see that, oh, there's only one slide. There's 35 animations here. So let's take state and local law is an interesting thing because there's been a lot of state and local activity with regard to immigration, and it has taken place in places like Hazleton, Pennsylvania would be one relatively early example of an ordinance that targets undocumented or unauthorized immigrants by making it much harder for them to get housing and to find jobs in that locality. Now, there are a couple of things that you might think in this context. And one is there an equal protection claim that you can assert in that situation because there's, in some sense, discrimination against people who are unauthorized? Now, that may seem like an absurd claim, and yet it's a sort of claim that a version of which prevailed in Plyler versus Doe in 1982, which says that undocumented children have a right to school access. They cannot be discriminated against just because they are here in the country illegally. It turns out the Plyler really has not gotten much traction in the last almost 30 years, but it's an example of an equal protection claim brought by someone who's here illegally. Another interesting thing about equal protection is that much of the testimony in the Hazleton case, and I think much of the political discourse about local enforcement, and you certainly see this with Arpaio, is that this is really about race. In other words, that even though there was, regardless of the statute being facially neutral, there's this sense, a lot of testimony in the Hazleton decision, this really was about race, this was really about targeting Latinos. There was an interesting discussion in that very long opinion about the need to allow the plaintiffs to proceed anonymously because of the fear and intimidation that Latinos felt in the city of Hazleton. So the question is, how do you assert that right? And those two strategies of asserting the right, the Plyler type right that you're protected even if you're undocumented, that did not prevail in Hazleton, and it generally has not prevailed. And the race question is very hard to pursue with regard to because of the intent requirements on traditional equal protection doctrine. So what happens? So what actually happens is preemption happens. What's interesting about the Hazleton decision is a decision that decides that federal law preempts state law. But what's interesting about that decision is the way it deals with preemption. It doesn't say that there is a facial conflict between federal and state law. In fact, the city of Hazleton was quite careful to make its local law turn on federal standards. What's interesting about it is a strong suspicion articulated in the preemption decision that immigration enforcement is discretionary, that discretion is very sensitive, and therefore it's preempted. Now, I can't help but think that one of the and I think this is very much borne out in the topics that the opinion talks about, that much of what drives the suspicion of discretion is a fear that that discretion will be improperly used. And this is an example, I think, of how equal protection ideas really drive preemption. So preemption becomes an oblique version of equal protection. Okay, so, and this is what I'm calling an institutional competence argument here. You can think about this, the wrong people decide because they're the ones who are more likely to be susceptible to the improper influences, for example, of race. Second, I'll go through a little more quickly. Workplace protections, I think you see the same sort of thing. There are a lot of wage and organizing remedies, which are basically the substance of a course in labor law and employment law. They can range from wages to organizing. It turns out that this is the full version if you were a U.S. citizen. It looks like, in cases like Hoffman Plastic, those rights have been diminished. But what's interesting is there are certain situations where those rights are recognized. And one of them is because the employer acted worse than you did in some way, either because they're the ones that didn't ask you for employment authorization or they're the ones that didn't pay you for work that you actually did. That makes them more comparatively culpable than if you didn't do the work at all. So if you look at this area of the statute, you have not only comparative culpability, but something I call citizen proxies, which is that many of these cases are driven by the idea that if we don't allow individuals in the workplace who are unauthorized to assert their rights, then that will actually hurt the other people in the workplace who are supposed to be there under law, namely citizens and permanent residents. So another thing that happens in some of these cases is a fourth thing that I'm calling procedural surrogates, and some of these rights are protected not by saying that the unauthorized immigrants actually have rights, but rather through rules of procedure, rules of discovery that say certain things like your immigration status are not discoverable. And sort of, it's also interestingly related to institutional competence, because I think judges consider themselves more institutionally competent or more comfortable speaking in the language of rules of procedure, evidence, and discovery. The third topic is search and seizure. Now, the full version of the right, I suppose if you're in criminal court, I suppose if you're a U.S. citizen, by definition, you shouldn't be in removal proceedings, but the full version of the right is the Fourth Amendment, and if evidence is brought against you using a search or seizure that violates the Fourth Amendment, that you're entitled to have that evidence suppressed under the exclusionary rule. That doesn't happen in immigration court. As Professor Chacon will address, we have a rule of the opposite rule, that you generally do not suppress evidence obtained in violation of the Fourth Amendment. That's not suppressed in removal hearings. But what's interesting here is that there are a couple of patterns that have emerged. One pattern is the egregious violation. So there's an exception to the rule that there's no exclusion or no suppression. There's an exception if there's an egregious violation. Well, I mean, this is an interesting thing, because then that sort of this oblique version of the full right. In the egregious violation, often it's a question of race. It can be other things. It can be a seizure that's too intrusive, even if it's not based on improper reasons. But what's interesting here is that you have a couple different things going on. I mean, one is, I think you have a comparative culpability dynamic, because the police are doing something worse because their violation is egregious. The second thing is that I think, to the extent that egregious violations are remedied more robustly, then you actually have behavior that is being punished, as it were, police behavior that's punished, that may visit harms on citizens as well as non-citizens. This is the kind, and so there's a citizen proxy effect here. So not all of these five mechanisms apply to all these four areas, but I'm just trying to point out some of the connections. The other thing that's going on is that the phantom norms idea, there's a case to talk about in the paper where the judge says that even though the particular, even though she's not going to suppress the evidence based on the Fourth Amendment, she is going to read the regulation in such a way to achieve the same result. And so the phantom part of the norm really is that it would not be what the Fourth Amendment would suggest, but it is what the regulation would suggest as she reads it. And the fourth area is immigration court. And the full version of the right here is you have a right to counsel. You have a right to counsel, and you have a right to an appointed counsel. The question is, this has been some controversy in the transition from the Attorney General Mukasey to Attorney General Holder. But what's happened is, what's emerged is the idea that even though you don't have a right to appointed counsel, that you do have a right to counsel that is effective. And that raises some of these issues as well, that it really means that the reason you need effective counsel, in other words, there should be a remedy if your counsel screws up, is because otherwise you're undermining the institutional competence of the immigration court. Because if you believe that immigration law is simply ministerial and not discretionary, then the right to counsel matters less. If you believe, however, that the really competent institution to make decisions is an immigration court, and that issues of immigration status are deeply contested, then it's fundamentally important that you have a right to counsel. Now, you may be wondering why I have these arrayed in the columns I do. What's interesting about this is, let's talk for a minute, in the minute I have left, about one thing that I think permeates a lot of the debate at various degrees of explicitness, and that is race. Let's think about how race plays out here. Let me set up, though, this spectrum here. The left side of the chart is really broad-scale stuff. I mean, this is really equal protection claims against ordinances that affect entire cities and even states, right? And so If you're concerned about the racially discriminatory effect of immigration enforcement, then this would be a way to think about equal protection against the law itself. But notice that the exclusionary rule, this is a more narrow scale, going down to the individual case. So I think many of the same arguments that are used to attack on equal protection grounds, attack local ordinances, but then manifest themselves in preemption. One could make those same sorts of arguments saying that the reason that the search was improper was because it was based on racial profiling. So if you think about race, there's a connection here. The red is just to indicate what I think is an interesting thing to think about, and I have to admit I have not fully thought this through. But you could think about race as really being at play in both racial profiling in Fourth Amendment cases and in the adoption of statewide or citywide equal protection, state or citywide local ordinances that target immigrants. You can think of race as moving, as being turned into a more oblique version of the same right if you manifest it in a preemption decision instead of equal protection decision. But notice how the same thing happens over here, where race is what gives power to the, through an egregious violation, through a finding of an egregious violation, it's what gives power to what would otherwise not be allowed as a Fourth Amendment remedy. And so preemption in this, the preemption idea in this sense is very similar to egregious and regulatory violations. So this is a, well, it's been a lot to describe in 16 minutes. but this is, I think, an important set of questions. I'm not sure I really have any answers. And I often, I admit, I often struggle with the question of that is always asked at every faculty workshop, which is, so what? But I see I'm out of time, so I won't answer that yet. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you all for coming. And thanks, special thanks to Natalie Bedoya for all her hard work and for the many organizers of the conference. It's a real pleasure to be here, and to all of the members of the Duke Law Journal who have done such a fantastic job and made this such a pleasurable event. And thanks to Reed, who's been wading through my footnotes and other aspects of this paper that I'm going to talk about now. If you can't hear me in the back, give me a hand signal at any time. I have the plague, I think, and I have been well have not been well for about a month, and my voice is now starting to fade. But I will do the best I can. What I'm going to be talking about today is kind of touches on some of the themes that Hiroshi already touched upon, in particular Fourth Amendment issues in the immigration context. When I thought about coming to this conference, one thing that should be immediately obvious from listening to my bio is I am not an administrative law person, although I do work in immigration law, so there are implications for administrative issues. But what I really focus on is criminal law and procedure. But what I found was one of the issues that I was concerned with focusing on at this particular point in time really implicated immigration adjudication. And so squarely kind of falls within the parameters of what we're talking about here at this conference. And I want to start my presentation today by reading a quote from a case, a 1984 case called INS versus Lopez Mendoza, which deals with the issue of the exclusionary rule and whether the suppression remedy is required or warranted in immigration proceedings when the Fourth Amendment has been violated. And here's the quote. Absent the applicability of the exclusionary rule, questions relating to deportability routinely involve simple factual allegations and matters of proof. When Fourth Amendment issues are raised at deportation hearings, the result is a diversion of attention from the main issues, which those proceedings were created to resolve, both in terms of the expertise of the administrative decision makers and of the structure of the forum to accommodate inquiries into search and seizure questions. The result frequently seems to be a long, confused record in which the issues are not clearly defined and in which there is voluminous testimony. So what the court is suggesting here is that immigration courts are really bad places to have to deal with the complicated, muddy questions of the Fourth Amendment, and therefore, for that and a variety of other reasons, suppression is really not an appropriate remedy, and certainly not one that is wisely litigated in immigration courts. I think that that really raises some very important issues when we turn to the contemporary context of immigration enforcement. A lot has changed since 1984 that I think requires us to think about this issue that the court flagged for us in 1984 when they said that immigration courts aren't good places to hear these kinds of claims. We are living in an era of unprecedented immigration enforcement. There's been a massive increase in enforcement. Between 2003 and 2008, the government removed 1,446,000 people. And these are kind of the tip of the iceberg, because for every person that's removed, another four people voluntarily depart under terms that aren't as voluntary as the title, as the label might suggest. So we're talking about large numbers of people that are kind of passing through the immigration enforcement system every day. And this is a significant, the numbers of removals are significantly higher than they have been at any time in the past. So we're really seeing new action. We're seeing new levels of enforcement in workplaces. You've probably all read about some of the big workplace raids that have taken place around the country over the past few years that have received some heightened attention. There's been a massive increase in the budget for immigration enforcement, both at the border and internally. There's been a massive increase in the staffing of departments that are dedicated to the enforcement of immigration laws. The number of ICE agents really tripled over the course of less than a decade. If we look back over this past decade, so a lot more immigration enforcement is happening. And added to that, a lot more players are involved in the task of immigration enforcement. So one of the notable features of the Lopez-Mendoza decision is that the court highlighted the fact that the INS had internal remedies that were dedicated toward dealing with the issues of Fourth Amendment violations. So when an INS agent violated the Fourth Amendment, there were a series of internal remedies that could be brought to bear on this individual that would curb the violation. And in fact, Justice O'Connor wrote that this would be much better than post hoc for a suppression as a means for dealing with possible constitutional abuses in immigration enforcement. This works, obviously, if you've got one, or may work, if you've got one agency that is subject to a series of regulations and that are enforceable upon that agency. But what we see very clearly now is that this is not within the purview of one agency, that it's not just the Department of Homeland Security through Immigration Customs Enforcement and Customs and Border Protection who are involved in the enforcement of immigration laws. But instead, we have a wide array of agencies at the state and local level, as well as the federal level, who are involved in immigration enforcement. In my paper, I focus specifically on various kinds of state and local participation in immigration enforcement, which I think highlights the shift in the legal landscape since the 1984 Lopez-Mendoza decision. And I look in particular at kind of three different forms of state-local participation in immigration enforcement. I start by talking about state and local involvement in immigration enforcement under Section 287G agreements. Section 287G, which was mentioned actually in the introductory remarks, was enacted into the Immigration and Nationality Act in 1996, and it allows for the cross-designation of certain trained state or local law enforcement officers to enforce federal immigration law. So what happens is the federal government signs a memorandum of agreement with a state or local law enforcement agency. Pursuant to that agreement, those state or local law enforcement agents are trained in particular aspects of immigration enforcement, and then they are empowered under the Immigration and Nationality Act to enforce immigration law. As a consequence of the training that they've received. And these memoranda of agreement vary in scope. So some are limited to the context of screening for unauthorized migrants in prisons. Others actually give officers the power to enforce immigration law kind of out on the beat. So it really depends on the scope of the agreement. Those are the most formalized methods of cooperation between state and local law enforcement officials and the federal government. They've received a lot of attention, both positive and negative, since since they were kind of kicked into operation. As I said, the 287G was enacted in 1996, but it really wasn't until the early part of this past decade that it became a real program in the sense that states and localities really began to sign on, and you saw a number of states and localities enter into these agreements, up to 77 at one point. And you also saw an increasing number of localities interested in getting some of these agreements, but unable to for a variety of reasons. So this is a relatively new development. It's been subject to a lot of criticism. And I'll talk about some of these criticisms in a little while. I think the virtue of the 287G agreement is that it's transparent. There's an agreement. It's written. There are terms of the agreement. And it is known which state and local law enforcement agents are participating in the enforcement of immigration law, and they are subject to training. Now, we can discuss all of those issues, but those, I think, are the virtues of the 287G agreements. In contrast, there is a whole kind of range of state and local participation in immigration enforcement that's not subject to the four corners of a formal agreement, but where state and local law enforcement agents are increasingly becoming a big part of immigration enforcement. Immigration and Customs Enforcement now has a whole series of programs that they put under the rubric of something they call ICE Access. And these ICE Access programs include a variety of ways in which state and local law enforcement are incorporated into immigration enforcement efforts. These include state and local participation in what are known as fugitive operations teams, trying to find and remove individuals who are illegally present in violation of a removal order. They also include state and local participation in the what's known as the criminal alien program, where they do, this particularly involves screening at the state and local jail levels, but also screening of arrestees for immigration status. It involves state and local involvement in operations such as Operation Community Shield, which is aimed at gang members and their associates, or Operation Predator, which is aimed at sex offenders. So state and local law enforcement have been brought into a variety of these operations, either providing support in the raid context or backup, providing information to ICE, or just running screenings on individuals who come into their who come to their attention in the course of everyday law enforcement. So it kind of scans a very broad spectrum with regard to the level and nature of state and local law enforcement. And I think that's important to flag because I think a lot of the discussion around state and local law enforcement kind of generically assumes kind of a 287G agreement. And I think the nature of state and local law enforcement is in immigration enforcement is actually changing. It's broad, and it really varies on the ground from place to place. And so I think it's important to keep that in mind. The upshot of all of this, however, is that large numbers of state and local law enforcement officials around the country are now very actively engaged at some level in the process of immigration enforcement. And the question that I asked myself as I was looking at the Lopez-Mendoza decision and some of the assumptions that undergird the outcome in that case was, what are the procedural implications of all of this? What does it mean or does it matter for criminal procedural protections that state and local law enforcement has now become involved very actively in immigration enforcement? And I think what I've concluded is that there are procedural implications. There are implications for constitutional protections in criminal investigations that arise as a consequence of all of this state and local participation in immigration enforcement. not to mention just the rise in immigration enforcement itself. So what are the procedural implications? What I try to do in this paper is walk through the ways in which there's a lack of alignment between the protections that apply in the investigation stage when it comes to investigating immigration violations, the gap between those protections and the protections that you would have in the investigation stage when you were dealing with a standard criminal case. And there are gaps. And some of them are not big, but they're gaps. And so one example, which comes into play probably frequently, is that, as you all know from your criminal procedure class, you've got your Terry stop, when you can stop someone on reasonable suspicion, obviously without a warrant. And we know that you can, when there's reasonable suspicion of a crime or threat to officer safety, that is that provides grounds for making a stop of someone. a brief stop. Brief stops which have been expanded increasingly by the court over recent years. In contrast, in the immigration context, if you look at the regulations for immigration officers, they're allowed to conduct these same kinds of brief stops when there's reason to believe that an individual is in the country without authorization. So that obviously includes not just belief of a crime, but also belief of a civil immigration violation. So there's additional latitude that's given to immigration officers to enforce immigration law, which makes sense because that is their job. But that latitude gets extended implicitly or some perhaps extra legally to law enforcement, state and local law enforcement who are engaged in immigration enforcement. Under the 287G agreements, it's extended lawful. It's extended kind of under the terms of the agreement to state and local participants in the 287G. In the case of someone like Sheriff Arpaio, it's extended or it's seized perhaps extra legally. He has decided that he has the authority to engage in immigration enforcement and to kind of empower himself and his officers to all of the latitude that these regulations would provide in the context of immigration enforcement. So that's one example of a rights gap. And there are others that we can talk about in the context of questioning of Miranda rights or lack thereof. But there are differences in the enforcement of immigration law and the enforcement of the criminal law. And as states and localities become more involved in enforcing immigration law, we need to ask, what are their powers? Do their powers kind of run concomitantly with the powers that immigration officers have to enforce immigration law, or are they limited by the powers that they have in the criminal investigation sphere? On top of the difference in rights, obviously, there's a difference in remedy, and that should be obvious from the discussion that Professor Motomura just gave and from my kind of lead-off with the Lopez-Mendoza decision. Even when Fourth Amendment rights are violated in the context of immigration enforcement, suppression is far from assured as a remedy. So the Lopez-Mendoza decision said immigration courts are not an appropriate sphere for adjudicating these kinds of concerns, and for the most part, it won't be effective anyway, and there are better remedies elsewhere. So in all but perhaps egregious cases of egregious violations, there's no need for suppression. So the consequence, of course, is that even when there are Fourth Amendment violations that take place, these Fourth Amendment violations may not necessarily be rights with remedies. Here again, I think it's relevant then that we now have state and local law enforcement participating as much as we do in immigration enforcement. I don't want to overstate. I think Immigration and Customs Enforcement and Customs and Border Protection are still the primary enforcers of immigration law. But you do have states and localities taking an active part in this enforcement now. And that kind of made me think back to MAP versus Ohio, the Supreme Court case where they concluded that unless the exclusionary rule is applied to states and localities in criminal proceedings, quote, the freedom from state invasions of privacy would be so ephemeral and so neatly severed from its conceptual nexus with a freedom from all brutish means of coercing evidence as not to merit this court's high regard as a freedom implicit in the concept of ordered liberty. So the sense was, if we don't apply this to states and localities, then we're going to have a larger problem. And I think that we can ask whether, as states and localities become very involved in partnering in the enforcement of immigration law, the absence of a remedy for Fourth Amendment violations in the immigration context raises some concerns. So why am I worrying about these things, and why am I worrying about them now? Obviously, there's been no suppression remedy in immigration proceedings for for over 25 years now. But I do think that we should think about this as something that we do want to be concerned about now, given the rise of the participation of state and locals and frankly, the overall rise of enforcement in the interior. We can think about this in some ways as related to the issue of citizen proxies that Hiroshi raised. These aren't obviously just the rights of non-citizens that are at issue or the right of the unauthorized migrant that's at issue when you have these violations without remedies in immigration proceedings. First of all, it obviously implicates lawful permanent residents who are caught up in raids, who are adjudicating immigration status in courts. And it also implicates citizens who live with or share neighborhoods with unauthorized migrants who might be the subject to more aggressive law enforcement as a consequence of the lack of appropriate remedies in the immigration enforcement context. So when we think about who's affected by this, we're not just talking about the 10.8 million unauthorized migrants, but we're talking about certainly at least the 22 million non-citizens living in the country, and we're also talking about citizens who are living with and working with non-citizens who have been subject to increasingly aggressive immigration enforcement tactics. So at the end of the paper, I try to talk about some possible solutions to what I see as a kind of a developing problem. I think it's in a nascent stage, but I do think it's a developing problem in this area. What can we do to ensure that this doesn't become a ubiquitous problem where there are much more aggressive policing tactics brought to bear in immigrant neighborhoods on the theory that these are going to go through immigration courts where rights are going to be without the same kind of robust remedies that they might have in criminal cases. And I think there are several solutions that we might want to think about. The one that's been most widely discussed, I think, is applying the exclusionary rule in immigration proceedings. And I think that may be something that we can discuss, and it may be appropriate. Certainly, immigration courts are dealing with these issues, Lopez Mendoza notwithstanding, every day. I recently spoke to someone who's litigating suppression issues in an immigration court and has been. Basically, the court has taken testimony on suppression issues 2 to 3 days a week for the last 6 months in a case. So immigration courts are kind of hearing complex suppression cases, notwithstanding Lopez Mendoza's desire to insulate them from having to hear these things. They are hearing them and spending a lot of time on them. They need to make determinations not only whether the Fourth Amendment has been violated, but then whether the violation arises to the level of egregiousness. So they are still making all of the complex decisions that Lopez Mendoza purported to remove from their purview. So that's one interesting possible solution, is to just incorporate the exclusionary rule. It seems to me that's part of a remedy, but it doesn't necessarily get at the larger issue entirely for some of the reasons that the Lopez Mendoza court talked about. In many cases, the kind of evidence that might be suppressed ultimately won't have an impact on the outcome of the case. It might therefore not really act as a particular deterrent. So I think it is a possible solution, but it may not be enough of a solution. And so I wanted to propose a couple of other points that need to be considered in connection with the restoration of the exclusionary rule in immigration proceedings in order to really get at the issue. One is goes to another point that Professor Motomura has already talked about, which is a right to counsel in removal proceedings. These issues of suppression are obviously complex. They're not the kind of thing that people are going to be litigating on their own, pro se. It's also true that immigration courts are not particularly trained to handle suppression issues, and so they frequently ask for extensive briefings on issues involving suppression, which is not something that someone representing themselves pro se is able to do. So the reinstatement of a suppression remedy in immigration courts would have some effect, but it would also be very limited by who's in immigration courts and their lack of representation. It may be that a lot of the rights violations simply would never be litigated, which leaves open the question of whether there is really adequate deterrence. But I think we also need to look outside of the courts for solutions. We need to look at the kinds of training that's happening both within immigration enforcement branches and their training of states and local officers who are participating in immigration enforcement. So one of the interesting things to me that happened in recent times was that John Morton in December of 2009 issued a memo saying, we're going to have Fourth Amendment training for our INS officials dealing with, for example, fugitive operations teams, which suggested that perhaps Fourth Amendment training had not been on the kind of a focus of great attention prior to that point, which may account for the rising numbers of allegations of rights violations against ICE. So certainly the idea of methodical and extensive training of agents who enforce immigration laws is important. And it's particularly important given the huge increase in the size of these agencies over recent years. When you hire 6,000 people to enforce the law, you're gonna have some problems. It's a quick ramping up of force. And I think it's important that the quick ramping up of force is accompanied by appropriate training for individuals who are charged with the enforcement of immigration law. And recent developments suggest that perhaps there hasn't been as much focus on training as there has been on hiring. And I think that probably needs to change. And then that, of course, extends to the collaboration between federal officers and state and locals. State and local officers are trained, obviously, in Fourth Amendment issues, and they also frequently have additional obligations that they have to meet under state law. What needs to be clarified is what their obligations are when they're enforcing immigration law. And I don't think there's been a lot of clarity for state and local law enforcement when they are entering into this realm. And I think that the result is that you get a real patchwork in terms of who's doing a good job and who's engaging in tactics that look questionable. And so you have a series of reports put out that suggest that state and local law enforcement in certain areas have engaged in very aggressive tactics of racial profiling, and it looks like these are the kinds of things that could be headed off by more appropriate training and by more appropriate attention to what their powers are in the enforcement of immigration law. So I think we can look to the courts, but I think we need to look beyond the courts. And so those are the kinds of issues that I wanted to raise in this paper. So I'll stop there.
I'm figuring for the comment period, I will make a few comments, but we're also going to be engaging in dialogue with one another. So I'm hoping that we'll just keep our seats, make this a little less formal than that podium would suggest for us. One thing that occurred to me as both of these really excellent papers were being presented is to wonder how well acquainted our audience is with the fact that there is a significant divergence between the rights of a so-called respondent in immigration court facing the possibility of deportation or exclusion and a criminal defendant in the criminal courts. How many of you were surprised to hear that there is no suppression or no exclusionary rule at operation in general in the immigration courts? Can I see a show of hands? Some of you were surprised to hear that, yeah. And I think that's a starting point that probably needs to be underlined. Immigration proceedings are regarded as civil proceedings rather than criminal proceedings. As a consequence, the whole panoply of criminal protections is not necessarily applied in an immigration proceeding, including things like a immigration judge is permitted to make a negative inference from a person claiming the Fifth Amendment right against self-incrimination. In criminal court, you say, I'm claiming the Fifth Amendment, and the jury is specifically instructed. You may make no inference about what would have been testified to here. In immigration court, the immigration judge can say, oh, well, I know about what that means. That means that the answer was going to incriminate you, and you're guilty. Not guilty, but you are subject to removal in many cases. So, too, with the exclusionary rule, as Professor Chacon has pointed to, and many other of the ordinary protections that we think are standard and are standard in our criminal cases are not in immigration proceedings. This is because the federal government, all the way up to the Supreme Court, regard immigration proceedings as non-criminal, and deportation or exclusion from the United States is not regarded as a punishment. It is regarded as a simple administrative act of putting a person where he or she belongs, instead of allowing him or her to stay where he or she isn't allowed to be. Think of it as a towing away a car that's illegally parked, rather than a punishment for having committed a crime. All of that is by way of quick preface, because I wanted to be sure you caught up with the context here. I want to talk about both of the papers, and I'm just going to, by fiat, talk first about Professor Motomura's, which I found to be, and I hope any of you who haven't had a chance to read it will. It's a brilliant piece, not only analytically, but I think practically. And this answers the question with which you left us, which was, so what? The so what is that this paper, which identifies five patterns which have been used by courts to provide penumbral rights to unauthorized migrants, this paper can give us litigants who are trying to fight for such rights five types of arguments to carry into the cases that we have, five kinds of things to look for so that we can give a judge some place to hang a determination that's favorable to our clients, those of us who are fighting for rights to be accorded to unauthorized immigrants. And those five patterns I thought were very interestingly arrayed. Institutional competence, having to do with issues of preemption of one entity in government taking over what probably ought to be, by the way, that's your pen, I stole it, sorry, what ought to be in the province mainly of the executive. The comparative culpability argument that somebody's done something worse than the illegal immigrant, the citizen proxy argument. Procedural surrogate, though, was the most interesting one to me because as you read the paper, you begin to see that by procedural surrogate, and I'll invite you to correct me if I'm over-reading here, Professor Motomura, but it's almost a way of saying that the court is hunting for some pretext in procedure to be able to afford a right that isn't in actuality given to the unlawful non-citizen. The phantom norm argument requires government to follow its own rules. And those five are very valuable, I think, as litigation strategies. Couple of further observations about Professor Motomura's paper, and then maybe I'll ask you to respond to the observations, and then I'll go on to you. Is that acceptable? Good. The paper that Professor Motomura gave us is limited in scope to unauthorized migrants to the United States, or illegal aliens, as some people like to call them. It does not look at the whole range of other non-citizens who are in the United States, people who are in authorized non-immigrant status, allowed to come here briefly for a limited time, a limited purpose. It doesn't address the case of people who are here as lawful permanent residents but not yet citizens. However, both of those categories of people, too, are subject to deportation under certain circumstances. And if you wanted to add a fourth or a fifth dimension to your paper, you could always add in some consideration of the types of protections that are afforded to those people, because they don't always get the whole full panoply, especially if they're in removal proceedings. As Professor Chacon pointed out, they don't get any of the criminal protections.
I would have to have a second slide, though.
Oh, dear. Yeah, let's forget that. Anyway, just a suggestion. Also associated with that, though, I have a question that I would like, perhaps, for Professor Motomura to give some consideration to. Is it possible that some unauthorized migrants might be entitled to a little more of the rights, these penumbral rights that you're pointing out, than others? And by that I mean there are some in the case law of the United States who essentially have no rights. In re Metze, a famous case in which the Supreme Court looked at a man who was attempting to get into the United States. He had left an Eastern European country, if I remember right, and was imprisoned on Ellis Island, asking to be released through writ of habeas corpus. The Supreme Court looked at him, said, well, he's got no place to go back to. He could not return to his home country. But we're not going to release him either. He stands at the door and knocks. There was secret evidence that the government had, or claimed to have, that made him supposedly a risk to release into the United States. And the Supreme Court said, you can do that. You can do that. Now, that whole precedent may be subject to some shaking as the case of the Uyghur detainees is coming before the Supreme Court, going to be argued March 23rd. But Mr. Metze and his kin, are they in the same position as, for example, Zadvydas, famous Supreme Court case, Zadvydas versus, I guess it was versus INS, that held that a person could not be indefinitely detained if he or she could not be deported, and there was no finding by a competent tribunal that he or she was either a threat to the community or a danger in some other fashion. Zadvydas had to be released. So I'm wondering about whether there is some kind of a scale there that is going to be forced upon you, even though you limit yourself to unauthorized migrants. And the final observation I have about this paper is that these patterns that you have identified all have a lot to do, I think, with integrity. They have to do with placing one authoritative level of government over others in terms of making immigration decisions. That has to do with the institutional competence issue. The comparative culpability argument seems to say, well, if a person has been badly enough mistreated by others, we as a society are going to overlook, to a certain extent, some wrong that that person has done. The citizen proxy argument is almost like the golden rule, do unto others as you would have them do unto you as a citizen. The phantom norm argument, similarly, if we make rules, we're going to require our own institutions to follow the rules that they have made, even though they may not be constitutionally mandated. All of those seem to suggest to me that the way that we treat, that underlying all of these things, there is a consciousness that the way that we treat those who are unauthorized in the United States is not so much about them and their status as it is about us and how we're going to deal with other people, how we're going to see ourselves in the long run. So I'll let you
bounce back. Thanks for those great comments and questions. I'll try to be brief and respond to a few of your questions and then just make another observation. I'm glad that you suggest an answer to the so what question. I have about five or six answers to that question, none of which I'm totally satisfied with, but it's nice to have other people answer the question for me. I should tell you, as an oblique response to what you to your so what and the question, is to tell you why I picked these five topics or four topics, because it's kind of an odd selection in some ways. And the way it really started is that I decided about 18 months ago to teach a course on immigrants' rights. And there are courses that are taught around the country in immigration law, certainly. But very few, I'm not sure I know of anyone that just, any other course that says, we're just going to talk about the rights of immigrants. In other words, not worry about status and how you acquire it and how you lose it. That's really what immigration law is about. But what are the consequences of status? I think this is the course that in some ways is becoming more relevant. Especially in Los Angeles, I have a lot of students who say, well, I'm not going to practice immigration law, but I'm going to practice law in Little Saigon, or I'm going to practice law in a situation where half of my clients are not going to be citizens. What are the consequences? And so I ended up deciding, really just made up a course from scratch and what I think should be in this course. And it became a course about labor law and education law and criminal procedure and driver's licenses and welfare and voting. And then I realized that I was seeing some things in the course that I'd never thought about before, but it was strictly from working through and making up this class for my students. So the subtitle of this paper really is what I learned in school last semester. It really is true. It's a course that came out of what my students made me think about. And so that may explain some of the pragmatic implications, because this is really an outgrowth of teaching. Second comment, I think you've hit upon what I think, what I now realize, of course, is one of the, if not flaws in the paper, something I need to really think about and address more explicitly, and that is, at least at a formal and superficial level, I treat all undocumented immigrants exactly alike. I don't really differentiate them for purposes of analysis. And yet it is entirely true, as you suggest, that the mechanisms that I suggest in the paper apply differentially. Now my formal excuse, although it's kind of a lame excuse, frankly, is that this is a book project and that's what the rest of the book is about. But I think a lot of the rest of the book is talking more deeply about undocumented or unauthorized migration. The book title, for those of you who can't wait for the book to come out, an essay version was published in the Columbia Law Review last December. It's called Immigration Outside the Law, which is a deliberately chosen term to avoid the words illegal, unauthorized, and undocumented. But it's called Immigration Outside the Law. And so this particular piece is intended, at least tentatively, as a chapter in the book. The third thing is really more a comment, really, not just on Jennifer Jacone's paper, but also, if I may anticipate, Christina Rodriguez's paper that we'll get to shortly, just to kind of pull all these things together, because I see all these connections. As I was listening, as you can tell, I like drawing pictures, and I was thinking, well, in these three papers, I made up a little triangle, and the triangle, one point is, one is the cynic, one is the pragmatist, and one is the optimist. But I couldn't figure out which
was which. One of these papers is about what people do in litigation, sometimes even on a guerrilla warfare basis, to get what they, it might look like they can't get and shouldn't get, but they feel they're entitled to. One of these papers is about legal reform. You know, you were talking about exclusionary rule, right to counsel, things of this nature. And one of these papers, and this is Christina Rodriguez's paper, is really more about institutional design questions and how can we think about agencies and the role of agencies vis-a-vis Congress, for example, in a way that as a matter of institutional design, works these problems at a level, I think, that is deeper and more anterior. I'm not sure which of these three papers is the most is the cynical paper, which was the optimistic paper, and which is the pragmatic paper. But I think it's a useful way to think about these three papers and see what answer you come up with to that question, if that's a way of thinking about it, if that's not too much like what your psychotherapist would ask you to think about. But that is a way of, and that's inspired by what you just suggested as well.
Thank you. Professor Chacon's paper was also delightful. I love the area of criminal law and the spillover, or lack thereof sometimes, and having practiced a great deal in front of immigration courts, it's very discouraging at times if you're acquainted with the kinds of protections that your clients get in the criminal courts, and then you walk into an immigration court. I received yesterday on a listserv from a North Carolina removal lawyer this comment. I will omit the name of the immigration judge involved. Immigration judge blank denied one of my bond motions recently because the Office of Chief Counsel, the immigration prosecutor, did not have the file after two attempts. In a real court, you would win your motion if the other side was unprepared twice. In these executive branch hearings, however, the government wins if it's not prepared or if the government agency removes your client from the venue. Of course, in real courts, the judge doesn't tell you in advance that he's already made his findings of fact before hearing testimony or argue his own objections and authority against evidence the opposing attorney was willing to admit. And my colleagues here, I hear some rueful laughter, and it's very appropriate because that's the way it works in immigration court. Kangaroos preside sometimes. Well, anyway, this the analysis of Lopez Mendoza, I thought, was very interesting and helpful because it's not a decision that many people are acquainted with since it's not criminal procedure, but it really is one that bears a great deal on those of us who try to practice in immigration court, not only that decision but some others that have essentially said this isn't criminal, you don't get protections. I think the larger, that there may be what I guess I could call a defendant's premium that may come out of the greater involvement of state and local law enforcement with immigration and customs enforcement. And here's what I mean by that. Both under 287G, where state and local officials are trained to go out and enforce the immigration laws, and also when they are operating cooperatively in joint ventures, if you will, with immigration and customs officers, something that can happen quite easily is that the ICE officers will take over and conduct an unlawful search, seizure. Well, if there's later a criminal prosecution based upon the evidence that comes out of that unlawful search or seizure, guess what happens in the criminal case? It won't happen in the immigration removal case, but in the criminal case, that stuff can be tossed out on a suppression motion. So there could be, and I have seen some cases like this, situations where there's a little bit of a dividend for the defendant because ICE agents were involved at the beginning of the investigation. It's a small comfort, but it does exist. One thing that I wanted to observe, and I would love to hear your comments on this, Professor Chacon, is the Obama administration has revised the Section 287G Memoranda of Agreement between state and local authorities and the federal government. Those memoranda, for a long time, weren't even available publicly, but they began to leak out and seemed to be drawn almost ad hoc from one jurisdiction to another. The Obama administration has standardized them, and one of the things that I observed in the copy that I saw most recently of this revised version was a very clear statement that the purpose of Section 287G involvement on the part of state and local officials is to get serious criminals deported rather than people whose taillights were busted when they were stopped by the police. And as I recall, the new agreement even suggests that local law enforcement officials are not empowered to ask about immigration status in the circumstance of a traffic stop, that kind of thing. So I'd love to hear your take on that. The other note that I wanted to make is that you're entirely right about the increasing involvement through legislation, usually in states and localities, that directs state and local officials, whether they are judicial officials or corrections officials and others, to try and dig up something about offenders' immigration status and then notify Immigration and Customs Enforcement if there's a possibility of deporting folks who are in, particularly in prison. That a law like that was passed in North Carolina just two sessions ago. And just yesterday, and this is something I left out of the news report, but just yesterday there was a proposal made, as I recall, in the Maryland House of Delegates, is that what they call it, of the same sort, directing prison officials to ensure that they did not release anybody from custody following the completion of a criminal sentence without determining that that person was or was not a citizen, and if not a citizen, contacting ICE. So I pass it over to you.
So I guess one good place to start, you mentioned the kind of difference between rights in criminal proceedings and rights in immigration proceedings. And for anyone who's kind of been on the criminal defense side, it's always funny to hear people talking about the criminal sphere as somewhere where there are really a lot of rights, you know, because that's not typically what you hear from criminal defense attorneys. But I think when you're living in the world of the relative, right, then certainly the protections in immigration courts are less. And this kind of stems out of the notion that you mentioned, the idea that deportation isn't punishment, which is a kind of an age-old determination the Supreme Court made in the 19th century, and it continues to be the law today. This is a civil administrative act. It's not punishment. And I think that makes sense on an intuitive level, that this is a corrective measure. It's designed to stop a violation, an ongoing violation of not criminal law but immigration law. The problem that we have now is that there have been so many trends that kind of undermine this notion of deportation as distinct from criminal punishment. For one thing, we see deportation increasingly used as an adjunct to criminal punishment for an increasingly large laundry list of crimes. So it's clear that Congress thinks about this as punitive, something that gets bootstrapped onto jail time as a means of punishing non-citizens, particularly lawful permanent residents who have violated the law. So it is seen as kind of it's been treated by Congress and spoken about by members of Congress as a form of punishment. The second thing that kind of undermines the distinction or makes it much more troublesome is the rise of immigration detention. So the increase of mandatory circumstances where detention is mandated have greatly increased since 1996. The number of people who are detained during the course of immigration proceedings has gone up. And if you've read kind of recent reports about immigration detention, there are troubling concerns about the punitiveness of immigration detention. So it's supposed to be civil detention. It's supposed to be short-lived, and it's supposed to be something that just keeps people in place to appear for their removal proceedings so that they are available for the courts and available to be removed as necessary. But often it plays out to be much more punitive than that. So there was a situation, a well-known situation in Texas a couple of years ago at the Hutto Detention Facility where children were being detained with their families in these detention centers without access to schools. People were in prison uniforms. So it starts to look increasingly punitive, and this notion that deportation isn't punishment when it's wrapped up with this much more punitive detention system starts to look a little bit more troubling. And the third thing that I think kind of troubles that deportation isn't punishment line is the fact that increasingly the way law enforcement views immigration enforcement is as an adjunct to its criminal law enforcement goals. And you can see this very clearly, for example, in the case of Operation Community Shield, which I referenced in my talk, which is the anti-gang initiative, where state and local law enforcement are cooperating cooperating with the federal government to remove non-citizens who are either gang members or their associates is the language that's used. And you can see here very clearly what the goal is to achieve a criminal law end through an immigration law means, right? So you don't have to actually prove a crime or put somebody in jail. You identify the individual as a potential gang threat, and then if they're removable, you use the immigration law system to achieve your criminal law end. So in all of these ways, the kind of what might be a clear distinction between criminal punishment on the one hand and removal, kind of administrative removal on the other, is a little bit more troubled now, I think, than it has been at times past. And so I think should raise questions in our minds, at least, as to what kinds of rights should be accorded in immigration proceedings. It doesn't necessarily answer those questions, but I think it should at least raise those questions for us. You talked about kind of a potential defendant dividend in criminal cases, where ICE gets involved early on, runs roughshod over the Fourth Amendment, and then ultimately the defendant profits from this. And you have seen that there's a case in Wilmar in Minnesota where there was suppression because ICE was overly aggressive in its conducting of a home raid, and the case was brought in criminal court, and the criminal court threw it out. And this is happening frequently. So in some ways, that could theoretically serve as a deterrent to ICE, right? Because the notion is if they wind up in criminal court, this evidence is going to get thrown out. So I think there is some deterrent on ICE conduct in that regard. And certainly if a defendant winds up in a criminal court, the full panoply of protections apply there. On the other hand, the same evidence that might be thrown out in a criminal court not going to be thrown out in a removal proceeding. So if you view removal as equally punitive or equally suited to achieving your law enforcement goals, then you have a choice of the forum where you'll be deterred or the forum where you won't. And I think that's kind of goes to the crux of the problem that I'm talking about here. You asked about the revisions to the 287G agreement, and this kind of the revision that you referenced really goes to a whole host of programs involving state and local cooperation. So the idea is that in the past, some of these programs have not really targeted serious criminals. They've just been kind of broadly used as a means of enforcing immigration law. And it's fine to enforce immigration law if you're ICE, but the concern is that if you get state and locals involved, then really what they ought to be focusing on are their common problems, which are non-citizens who are not only here without legal authorization, but who also pose some sort of a criminal threat. And the concern was that state and local involvement had really kind of permeated well beyond those bounds and was becoming run-of-the-mill immigration enforcement when it really didn't kind of fit in with their broader law enforcement goals. And so you've seen this discussion in the context of 287G. You've seen this discussion in the context of the criminal alien program. You've seen this discussion particularly in the context of the fugitive operations teams, where it looked like a lot of the people they were targeting didn't even have outstanding removal orders, let alone a criminal offense. So they were just targeting for civil immigration violations. And one of the kind of statements coming down from the new administration is really the focus of these programs, the fugitive operations teams, the 287G agreements, particularly where state and local officers are involved, is that the focus should be on non-citizens who are committing crimes, who are contributing to the crime problem, and that should be the focus there. I think, there's not really much of an enforcement mechanism in place to ensure that the states and localities comply with the dictates from on high. So much depends on what they perceive as their prerogative in this sphere. One of the interesting things about the revisions to the 287G program that I write about a little in the paper is the administration announced some changes to the 287G program, and the reaction to the administration's decision to revise 287G, to me, just summed up the immigration debate generally. On one side, you had immigrants' rights advocates saying, this does absolutely nothing. It doesn't improve the situation with 287G at all. They will continue to run roughshod over rights. There'll be continued racial profiling as a consequence of state and local involvement in immigration enforcement, and the minor tweaking that the administration has done to these agreements will do nothing to help. What's more, it seems to add a layer of secrecy. Getting the information from states and localities about these agreements is going to be even more difficult. So it actually, if anything, has just made the situation worse. On the other side, kind of from the more restrictionist camp, the scuttlebutt was, this has just gutted the 287G program, right? So I think to me that really spoke to how completely disengaged the two sides of the immigration debate really are. There was no overlap in how people perceived the changes to the 287G agreement, and it spoke to kind of a larger question of about, and I think it's because there are underlying concerns on the one side about state and local law enforcement generally. They just don't think they should be involved. So any tweaking of 287G is not going to be sufficient. And on the other side, there's a clear sense that a civil violation of immigration law is a crime that should be enforced by anybody and everybody. And there's no overlap in that kind of a position, and that kind of reared its head, I think, when the 287G revisions were announced. So I guess I'll stop there, and we have only a few minutes left, I think, for questions anyway. So
yeah, let's take some questions. Right here.
So I guess I have a question. It's mostly about Hiroshi's paper, but I think it actually links to both of them. And Hiroshi, I love the five kinds of arguments, so I want to add another dimension just to make it further complicated, to try to think a little bit about your kind of like, so what question, what's the paper really doing? Because I think it's doing a bunch of interesting things. And so let me suggest maybe three different things that it might be up to. One is kind of descriptive, one is maybe motivational, and one is more kind of creative. So on the descriptive front, and this I think is what things really close to both of you are interested in, just trying to actually suss out, like, and persuade people about our campus. Says, okay, here's how we should understand on the ground the actual structure of rights that unauthorized migrants have. What I think is hard about that, so I think a challenge, and I find this in my own work too, is the sort of conceptual baseline question, right? So you need some account of what a full right or full entitlement is in order to compare to, and it's not always clear what the right comparison should be. So to take the right to counsel stuff, I don't know whether we should think about it as properly compared to criminal context or to lots of other civil contexts, like child protective services and other sorts of things where it looks a little bit more like the immigration context. So kind of embedded in there, I think, is a set of normative claims about, well, what the right comparison is. I guess, relatedly, I'm sort of interested in your choices of the four categories. You might have picked other things where it actually is really clear that pretty much everybody, regardless of their status, has rights. You thought about, say, access to courts. Like, nobody disputes the fact that, you know, whatever your status, you can sue someone in court, in a local court, or property ownership, right? And that wasn't always true, right? I mean, property ownership, founding period is really contested, but now it's like completely established. It doesn't matter if you're crossing the border and, living in countries without an authorization, you can, it may be harder to get a mortgage from a bank. There's other issues, but like as a formal matter, you have the right to own property. So it seems like to me there's an array, actually. There are some of these sort of intermediate categories, and you've really picked out a bunch of them, but there are some places where it's more clear than in one direction. On the motivational thing, I felt like sometimes in the paper, what's really interesting is I think you're suggesting that the courts think there's something else going on, like racial discrimination, and they're using these tools just to get at it. And if that's true, then I guess, what one of the things that I think is interesting is asking why they would do that. So what would motivate them to choose the indirect route instead of the direct route? And I don't know if it's something about the sort of historical path of law or contemporary judicial hierarchy. So it could be that, well, we've got a lot of lower court judges who don't have the same vision of migrants' rights that say the Supreme Court does. And so they use these tools because they don't pull along with more direct intervention. I don't know, but it's interesting to try to figure out why they would do this. On the flip side, I think the consequence, sort of thinking as a lawyer, is there's interesting consequences for kind of rule of law and structure and formality, right? So if you're using these sort of indirect tools, then you might see intervention protection like look more sporadic. It might turn a lot more on who your judicial panel is or what part of the problems. And then the pretty good thing, I think also when I looked at the paper, I thought, well, maybe this is a claim about when we should see migrants as peer. So like maybe the citizen interest example is a really good one. It's kind of like the old interest convergence claim about the civil rights movement. Like, when do we see rights for African Americans finally protected? Well, when it happens to converge with the interests of whites. And maybe that's part of what's happening. You say, so when will we see what Fourth Amendment rights protected for people from the status, but when it happens to converge with the rights of citizens who have sufficient political power to make their voices heard. Right? So I think each of these could be kind of really interesting aspects of the paper. So I guess it's kind of a question about which one you think is most you most want to pursue, or whether you want to pursue them all, or whether you think I just
I'm not sure how we are doing on time. I mean, I can give you like a 30-second answer, and I don't want to take more than 30 seconds.
Or you can give me no answer, I don't care.
I think the categories question is really interesting. I mean, and one thing to talk about in the paper is that in the argument for Plyler versus Doe, Justice Marshall asked the lawyer for Texas, like, could, if you were in the country illegally, could you ask for fire protection? And the lawyer didn't understand the question, and Marshall says, F-I-R-E. That's what I'm asking about. One interesting thing is implications. I think there's a certain jeopardy of those kinds of things going on, for example, in family law out there. So so in some ways, there's the more clear, maybe that's why I avoided them, but they also are not as well entrenched as one might think. I think this really is a question about judging, and I'm not sure exactly how to go about that, both in terms of how I think about it or how methodologically one pursues it. And a lot of the stuff is about mapping. I mean, you know, I think I've been probably rightly accused of just drawing maps my whole career of what goes on out there, and maybe I'm going to just at this point plead nolo to that.
How are we on time, Natalie?
I can go to
okay, yes. Professor Rodriguez.
I have a quick question for each of you. My first question is actually it's related to what you just asked, Adam, about Hiroshi, your paper. The concept that falls out of the paper, in part because I think most of the categories are very pragmatic at their core, is the concept of personhood, which applies by virtue of the 14th Amendment's use of the word person as opposed to citizen. And the reason why, for example, equal protection claims were not viable in court, and this is a partial answer to Adam, is that that door has been closed because of the doctrinal way that it's developed, not because undocumented immigrants are not persons for the purposes of the Equal Protection Clause. State interests might mean they get less scrutiny, but it's not because of the absence of some status as a person before the Constitution. And I think what you're mapping here is instances in which undocumented immigrants, as undocumented immigrants, come before the law, but as Adam's question suggests, there are many areas where the status is not relevant to the determination. It's not relevant to the state interest. And that state interest can creep in some of those instances, but it doesn't necessarily. And the other really good example that I actually think you might want to use in the labor law section is the way the courts have adjudicated attempts to restrict day laborers and the use of anti-solicitation ordinances that are facially neutral but are clearly targeted at mostly undocumented immigrants gathering. And maybe it's because it's the First Amendment and courts love the First Amendment or some other reason, but the courts almost uniformly have found their First Amendment associational interests that undocumented immigrants have. And so it's just kind of another way of asking this whole realm of regulation where there might be some value to the personhood. But I do think that one thing that's very distinctive about what you are writing is it demonstrates how in the American context, a lot of these questions have to get filtered in through these pragmatic doctrines like preemption or institutional competence or whatever it is, because there is no coherent conception of what it means to be a person and what that means constitutionally, whereas in the European context, a lot of courts grappling with this actually focus on the concept of dignity, the inherent dignity of the person as a limitation on the state's authority, and we don't lack that, but I think your paper shows that very nicely. And then just very quickly, Jennifer, one thing that was really interesting at the end of your comments, when you talked about the need to train IJs to conduct suppression type analysis, and to train ICE officials to do that sort of thing, is that state and local police actually do that all the time, right? They're very good at that. So that might be an instance where the learning could go the other way. And mm-hmm. it's an argument for 287G, mm-hmm. but then I think the related question is the fear either that they'll start to unlearn that practice, so it'll have implications in the criminal context, or that they will come to unlearn it in the immigration context. But that's a really interesting difference, I think, merits some exploration. Yeah.
You know, my colleague at UCLA, Adam Winkler, wrote a piece that came out in the Michigan Law Review in November about it's called Free Speech Federalism. And I think this question of the First Amendment and how it's interpreted applied to day laborers is really, I realized that that's a very interesting question because it does implicate these issues. And dignity, I think, is an important way to think about it. It's similar, Hans, to what you were saying about how we treat each other. I reminded that when my book, Americans in Waiting, came out, the first place that asked me to talk about it was conference in Brevard organized by 15 churches in Western North Carolina. And I was a co-panelist with the minister of the Etowah Methodist Church who paralleled what she did was she ended up talking about all of my constitutional arguments and how they're rooted in the Bible.
So I think this is a really interesting question. And it's one of the things that is interesting about the idea of, you know, states and localities are trained in the Fourth Amendment, right? And we've seen instances where state or where local law enforcement has actually been kind of verbally appalled by ICE conduct. And we saw it in Nassau County recently with some home raids that took place there. And much older case back with the INS, the LAPD appalled by ICE conduct. And so I think what you have really is a kind of a patchwork. You have some local law enforcement who are much more, I think, rigorous about their kind of their Fourth Amendment standards, and they tend to stick with them regardless of whether they're policing in largely non-citizen communities or the community at large, and often in big cities where you have large non-citizen populations, it behooves them to police fairly, and I think there's a real impetus there. And then in other places, you see, I think, seepage where the learning does seem to go the other way. Where once empowered to enforce immigration law, there is a tendency to think that this is an area where some of the standard protections really don't apply or oughtn't apply because you're dealing with a population that's not authorized, and the problematic. The problematic development that you get in some of these places is a lot of racial profiling, a kind of a visible increase in racial profiling in areas where state and locals have been kind of drafted into this process and have decided that that is a realm where some of their standard practices are not going to apply. So I actually do think that there is learning that can run both ways. And I actually think that there are some states and localities who've really distinguished themselves in terms of how they police across the board. And certainly have shown themselves to be more scrupulous about policing than ICE in certain instances. The problem is that it's not consistent. And then once you've got kind of a procedural loophole, then it's easy for agencies that are already inclined to police in an overly aggressive manner to latch onto these loopholes and take advantage of them. And we've seen some of that.
One quick one, Deborah Weissman from our sister institution 9 miles south.
Thanks. Jennifer, I wanted to push a little bit on your four possible solutions and put it in a context that's not necessarily regional, although it might sound to be, and that is that when we think about training collaboration, particularly on some of these state and local programs, we have to remember that most of these programs are being implemented in the South.
Right.
North Carolina has the second largest number of 287G programs. Mm-hmm. Secured communities, which again is part of your ICE access description, was piloted in 2 southern states, North Carolina being one of them. Mm-hmm. And underneath much of this is, you know, thinly disguised, if disguised at all, you know, nativism and racism. And those of us who've been, you know, reading any newspaper here, what ought to be a litigator's delight in terms of the intentional and really horrific discriminatory statements made by chief law enforcement officers about this. And so it really permeates how these programs are implemented on the ground level. So the training and the collaboration, I think, is really problematic. Mm-hmm. And also backing up to one of your earlier statements about whether 287G is a little bit better because, you know, sort of the parameters are laid out in the four corners of the contract, we know from the GAO reports that there's absolutely no oversight, no implementation. And as you said, the changes are pretty meaningless. And not only are they meaningless on paper, but the sheriffs have been reporting nobody from Homeland Security, nobody from ICE has been monitoring them, even after the changes.
Yeah.
The other thing that concerns me about the training is that the GAO report, having nothing to do with state and local implementation of immigration back in, I think it was October 2007, if not 2006, found that ICE officers were poorly trained on straight-up immigration issues. they were so far behind changes in the law that mm-hmm. they were making egregious mistakes in the field just because they couldn't keep up with, mm-hmm. with that. So then I want to turn to your first proposal for solutions, which I thought you were not all that excited about. And this, I think, relates to maybe how to push, this is the optimism in me, from full rights, from oblique to full rights, and that is in immigration proceedings and exploitation.